just to be clear. Okay. So that's a key thing here about the countries of former Yugoslavia, right? Nationalism war creates authoritarian regimes with weak and new opposition until state is established. This is why there's a second stage. This is why 2000 for me is a better cutting thing, because after 2000, basically most of these states are established. After 2000, you have Slovenia, you have Croatia, you have Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is a whole different case because it's basically an international protectorate. It's not, doesn't function on its own at this point for reasons of post-war division into different ethnic groups. Then you have small Yugoslavia at this point still. This is 2000. Let's just look at that. So in 1999, right? In 1999, what you have is a small Yugoslavia from which Kosovo is sort of an autonomous part. It's not independent, but it's under international protection, just like Bosnia and Herzegovina. And this smaller Yugoslavia contains Serbia and Montenegro. This won't last because Montenegro gets tired of being associated with Serbia, the pariah of Europe at this point. So in 2003 or so, in 2003 or so, 2006, Montenegro breaks from Yugoslavia, so now you have Serbia and Yugoslavia. In 2008, Kosovo proclaims its sovereignty. That small province proclaims itself as a sovereign state, and interestingly, so many countries recognize it, right? The statehood depends on recognition, but many countries don't. And we might be able to discuss why and how a little bit later. But Kosovo, this historical province of Serbia, populated mostly, however, by Albanians for all these historical reasons. But now you understand how important it is for Serbia. And you let it, how can you let it become its own state? When that is the, right? It's the heart of national identity. Battle of Kosovo and so on. So, Kosovo becomes an independent province, independent state in 2008. Serbia obviously didn't recognize it, but by that time it has to give in. Right? We'll talk about these things. But by 2008 you have Slovenia, Croatia, Bosnia, Serbia, Montenegro, Kosovo, Macedonia, all of these having been part of Yugoslavia. Right? But after 2000, what you have is basically things change to a degree. But you still, I think that we can still think of these three categories. And after 2000, I would group them as follows. I would group them as, again, the middle tier, the fast track tier, being Poland, Czech Republic, now Slovakia as well. Slovakia was in the slower tier in the 90s with Romania and Bulgaria because it was actually dominated by nationalism. Nationalism directed against the Hungarian minority there. And it had a more illiberal bent. But that changes in 2000. So in 2000 you have basically this tier here with Slovenia, and I would also include Croatia, why not? There. But you see again the pattern, the historical political cultural pattern. Again, not deterministic, that it had to be and the history shapes future and whatever, but there are continuities. And then the second tier is still Romania and Bulgaria. Second tier, but no longer so behind, because by the middle of 2000s, all of these countries are part of the European Union. Their goals of 1989, back to Europe. Well, they understood Europe as obviously the cultural space. European Union is a very specific set of institutions. It's a political entity. They are accepted. However, by the middle 2000s, all of these except for Croatia are part of it. 2013, Croatia also joins. So today, all of these are part of the European Union. Slovenia, Croatia, Hungary, Slovakia, Czech, Poland, Romania, Bulgaria, part of the European Union. Which is a guarantee of. And it was an engine also, as your book explains very nicely. of political progress, stability, economic development, pumped a lot of investment also in these countries, and also it sort of served as a watchdog that reforms progress. And in many ways, these two countries are still sort of considered to be a little behind. And their economic, especially certain aspects, for example, rule of law, the functioning of courts, corruption, that's a key ongoing problem here. Okay, but all of these are democratic, multi-party systems, all of these, and part of the European Union. Then, so, but anyway, you can save them faster, a little bit slower, but now part of the same group of European Union. And then you have the what is nowadays called Western Balkans. The Western Balkans are the countries of basically former Yugoslavia. Bosnia, Serbia, Montenegro, Kosovo, Macedonia. And all of them want to be part of the European Union, because again, the European Union is understood as this place of political, economic security. You see how it connects with the 1989 image of that place where we live well in peace. Yeah. And again, notice the parallels. Notice the historical parallels, notice the political, cultural background, and so on. And I'm going to end on that note, right? Because these are just some generic, right? Some generic considerations about these countries, about transition, about the challenges of transition. And then we will look at certain case studies in the next section more specifically. We'll dedicate ourselves to different few of these countries. It's worth. Right. It's first to understand what are the challenges, and that's what we, you know, we looked at today, the political challenges, and the next thing to look at will be the economical challenges or the challenges of economic transition. And I said that I'm going to end on this note with just mentioning again the important role of the European Union back to Europe, as your book mentions, is both a destination, but also as a very good reinforcement of the path on which they were engaged. There was a clear end goal that we are going this way in order to get into the European Union, and the European Union is this space of guaranteed stability, security, political democracy. European Union, which is a set of institutions where, you know, all these states are still there, have their own governments, of course, but they also take some decisions together, and they also basically help each other, so to speak. Right? It's a very vague way to put it, but this is not, of course, on the European Union, so I don't have time to go into detail. But it's very important that there was a very clear goal, and that was very important, especially in these countries here. And today it is very important in these countries here, because all of them want to be part of the European Union. And your book mentions nicely that, you know, even leaders that used to be nationalistic or whatever in Serbia and whatever are now pro-European, so to speak, because they see Europe as the, or the European Union rather, as the only possible good future for their country. They are patriots in that sense. And they know, well, what is the alternative? Authoritarian Russia? That is the path. Okay, so that was these are some considerations about political transitions in Central Eastern Europe in general. And we will continue with economic transitions.